Well, thank you all so much for inviting me and for hosting me here. This is my first Dakota ever, and it's certainly the best Dakota I have been to so far. Especially with the sunset just now, you guys are really like putting on your A game for me, and I appreciate it. So to tell you a little about myself, you know, I grew up in a pretty much completely atheist home. I grew up on Long Island in New York, where most people I knew were secular Jews. So I had really almost no background on Christianity practiced among the people I knew. And that was something I really started to discover only when I went to college and was fighting with people, and kind of learned, to my surprise, that they were at least differently wrong than I thought. So I'd have a lot of kind of arguments where it would turn out that the position I was rebutting wasn't one Catholics actually held. And I wasn't discouraged. I just thought I should do more research and then come back and explain why they are wrong. Not a bad way to read Chesterton. Like, Chesterton would appreciate reading Chesterton that way, I think. And you know, this ultimately resulted in my conversion as I was kind of exploring what I did believe to be true and what it would take for kind of my beliefs in objective morality to work, and what it would mean for them to work in the absence of God, and what it would mean for them to work in the presence of God. But the reason I'm not kind of telling the story of my conversion tonight, there's a couple of reasons. One is that it takes 2 hours. I've tried so hard, it takes 2 hours. Second reason is that it starts with, I began as a deontologist, like, which I find super interesting. But the problem with conversions is that, you know, they're not kind of universal keys for why Catholicism is true. I can't tell a utilitarian or a nihilist, like, here is why Catholicism is true. I can go, did you start in the same place I did? I know the map from there to Catholicism. Like, you go along this ridge, then you change your mind and kind of do a virtue ethicist thing for a bit. Like, you run into like a little bit of a ravine, but if you just like scoot around there, ah, Catholicism, yes. People sometimes ask me like, oh, what about like on the other side of the mountain? Like, I've never been over there. Like, I'm pretty sure we're right, so there must be a path up, but I do not know that one. So for me, you know, really, what the moment of conversion is more like, and the reason why it's everything afterwards that's had a much more arresting for me, is it's kind of like in the moment of discovering the door to Narnia, right? Like, you've just had a whole new world open up, and the most exciting thing is the world itself. It is not asking Lucy, how did you decide on the wardrobe as a place to hide? Like, take me through right up to that. I'm like, guys, sorry, there's a forest. Like, let's do that thing. But the problem was, I kind of had more trouble with Lucy with the actual transition into this new world, because I was a lot less like Lucy and a lot more like Eustace Scrub. So then I kind of like stepped across, like it's true, but didn't know how to live in this new world. You know, Eustace Scrub winds up in Narnia on a boat surrounded by talking rats and goes, I would like to speak to someone at an embassy. Like, he brings over all the old rules of his old world. He doesn't know how to live in the new one. And I had kind of the same problem. I'd spent all this time reading about religion and arguing about religion, and I was pretty good at both of those things. But those are both subsets of thinking about God. And prayer is the task of thinking with God. And I had no practice at that. Here's exactly how bad I was at that, just so you can like calibrate your expectations accordingly. There was a bit before I actually converted when I had asked, you know, the very nice Catholic boy I was dating, you know, during Lent, is there anything you want me to try or to do that would help me notice if Catholicism is true, that would kind of open doors on my side? And he said, why don't you try praying? I'm like, how, what, does that a thing, okay? And he's like, go ahead, like, you can just pray, like, you can just, and I'm like, no, I actually, like, I can't. Like, two problems. Like, I have the problem if I don't believe in God, so it's, like, hard ontologically. But also, like, what? And so what we wound up doing, which he thought was ridiculous, I was like, why don't you pray, like, out loud or whatever you want, like, you pray, and then say to God that I'm about to pray, and then I'll go. So, what? Like, no, this is super reasonable, secretly, hang on. He's like, no, what do you mean? Like, you can just talk to him. Like, no, I don't know how to talk to God, but you, like, if there is a God, you do, right? So you can, like, talk to God and, like, pass me the phone. And he thought I was crazy, but that's what we did, and I didn't really have that much to say at the time. But I was like, well, at least I know him praying. Like, if praying is a thing, that was praying, what he was doing, and I'm in the middle of his prayer. And then he goes back and, like, hangs up with God, so, like, that's prayer. Like, that's fine. After my conversion, though, like, I had two problems. Like, I wasn't still dating the guy. And even if I were, I couldn't really call him up and be like, ah, Chris, I'm Catholic now. I need you to, like, help me start praying. And then I'll go on, and then you can, like, end the praying again. So I kind of still had to find my way into this. How am I going to spend time with God rather than spend time with books about God? And so especially since I was becoming Catholic, I was like, well, like, if I want to know that I'm praying, like, and if I want to know that I'm a Catholic praying, I'm going to do the rosary. Like, I cannot think of a more Catholic thing to do. This will probably work itself out well. And to be honest, it was enormously helpful. It was enormously helpful just because I knew when I was praying, you know, I wanted to offer something to God, but I was just beginning, and I could pick up a rosary and start at the beginning and go on to the end, and kind of not be distracted as I was doing it, even with the question of, am I praying for long enough? Like, am I saying the right things? Like, am I doing a good job at, like, inventing a way to speak to God, a person I have just met, you know, as far as I'm concerned, in the moment as I go? No, like, I have been given something. You know, I've been given a lot of things, but I've particularly been given the rosary as a way that we know God has offered to us to speak to him. And I can pick it up and I can just start and keep going and trust that this was given to me and keep on going till I hit the end. And I'll know that I've been praying. I'll know that I've offered something to God. And that was pretty helpful to me and really helped me deal with a lot of my anxiety and self-consciousness around prayer. And it helped for a bit. And then as I started to get better just the logistics of praying the rosary, then I started to worry again. So, you know, now I knew I was successfully praying the rosary in the sense that I was saying all the words in the right order. Yes. But now now that I was kind of past that initial stage, I was more worried about what I was supposed to be doing with the praying part as opposed to the speaking part. I knew I was supposed to be meditating on these mysteries, but I didn't really know what that meant. And especially, you know, when it came to a mystery like the crucifixion, I didn't even know how to approach it. You know, it would be one thing to meditate on something very small, like the visitation, two people meeting, and I could think about that, but to go like, okay, now for 10 Hail Marys, I will think about Christ giving his life for me in this particularly horrific way, and it's fullness. How on earth am I supposed to do that? What am I supposed to bring to this mystery? Or if I just spend the whole time kind of going, oh no, like, is that meditating? Maybe? I'm not sure. And this is where, you know, in a lot of my prayer, like, when I panicked, luckily, you know, I would turn to anything to help me find my way through this. And a lot of the time that turned out to be secular sources of order, of beauty, of anything that had pointed me as a guide that I could kind of fall back on and go, all right, this is new. What can make sense of this for me? And what actually wound up really helping with the rosary was ballroom dance. So I'd been taking ballroom dance lessons for a while. In fact, all through college, I'd been trading ballroom dance lessons with that Catholic boyfriend for mass attendance with him. Which I figured was a foolproof bargain because he learns by virtue of showing up and I just show up and, oh, never mind. So we both came out winners in that one. But I'd spent a lot of time in ballroom dance, and the interesting thing is that when you think about ballroom dance performed, you know, it's all the lifts and the turns and everything that's fancy about it. And if you've never been to a class, you might picture that what the class is practicing those turns, you know. Make sure your feet are in exactly the right place. Like, how do you do this next one? Oh, here comes a complicated bit. And in actuality, most of learning ballroom dance, if you're a follow like I am, is learning just the basic. And the basic is the rhythm of the dance, and that's it. So if I'm learning the cha-cha, like, a lot of my practice time in class and out is not spent on how exactly do I do a turn. It is spent just on, like, one, two, cha-cha-cha, three, four, cha-cha-cha, again, one, two, again, and again. And the summer I was taking classes intensively, I was just practicing it on the subway platform, like in line, at Starbucks. Because my actual only job in ballroom dance as a follow is picking my feet up and putting them down at the right time. If I do that, that's actually the only work I'm asked to do as a dancer. It's much harder for leads and for boys generally, so sorry. But I'm not even supposed to put my feet in the right place. If I'm trying to put my feet in the right place, I'm anticipating my partner and I'm probably going to screw things up. All I have to do is lift them and put them down, and they should wind up in the right place because my partner moved me, and if they don't, it's actually his fault. Every ballroom teacher will back me up. It is actually the lead's fault when I screw up a step, no matter in what way I screw it up, as long as I've kept the basic rhythm. So the goal in practicing the basic again and again and again is just to get it into my bones so that it's completely natural for me to move in this slightly unnatural way, so that with the slightest motion from my partner, I'm ready to wind up in the right place with me doing the right rhythm. And I could kind of calm down a little about the rosary when I thought about it in that way. You know, God wasn't asking me to take the rosary and wrest meaning out of it, you know, and derive new insights into the life of Christ that no one else had ever had before. God wasn't even asking me to do something unique for me. God wasn't asking me to create spiritual consolation for myself by sheer act of will and impressive meditation. My job is just to be present and be ready to move. And the entire rhythm of the prayer and the guidance I'm given is about being able to be responsive to any motion God asks of me, not to create it all myself. And so that when I have a boring rosary, you know, that's not a failing in me any more than a boring practicing of the basic is. Like, I don't ask of practicing the basic that it entertain me, or that I look really awesome while I'm doing it, or that it's a good story later. It's all just to get this in my bones. And the rosary was a tool given to me and a gift given to me to be able to get part of the life of Christ and of Mary into my bones so that I could respond to anything else that was offered to me, to give me a vocabulary for understanding what else God might offer. And sometimes I was lucky, you know, that like as I relaxed a little and delegated more of the rosary to God and held on for me the part that was actually my work, you know, there were things that were kind of beautiful that I had the opportunity to see when I made it less of my job to spot them. And in fact, a lot of what I did was kind of like sneak around the edges of the rosary because I was still a little scared of meditating on the full mysteries of Christ. Since they were very large, I didn't want to do them wrong or screw them up. So I would look at the mysteries and go, oh yes, you know, like the crowning of thorns, right. Okay, that's enormous and it's not even the biggest. Okay, I'm backing up a little bit in my meditation. Like, Christ is very large and very difficult. I'm going to think about someone at the periphery of this story and like work my way in. And so I ended up like just meditating on the person making the crown of thorns. I was like, that's near the story. Like, work my way in from the side. And thinking about just, you know, what it is to make a crown of thorns for someone, like how this fits into the other mysteries, how it fits into our relationship with Christ. Usually we have two mysteries of his suffering as inflicted by other people in the story right next to each other, the scourging at the pillar and the crowning of thorns. And I wasn't even at that point looking at the people. I'd like retreated one more step and was just looking at the instruments for a second. And the weird thing or the interesting thing that struck me was that, you know, when you make a whip, there's nothing about the process of making it that makes the suffering you're going to inflict alive with you. It's braiding, it's curing leather, it's boring, it's like any other task. But you can't make a crown of thorns without pricking yourself, without having literal empathy for what you're going to do to someone else with what you're making. So I can understand making a whip, but how do you sit there and coil something together feeling a small version of what you're going to do to someone else and then offer it to them? Well, I can understand that actually, right? Because I do that sometimes. That sometimes what's happening is when I'm doing something bad, something that's going to hurt someone else and hurt me, the pain can almost be proof of my fortitude. That, you know, you could imagine not just making a, like not just casually looping, but no, I'm going to braid this. I'm going to do a really good job. Oh, like it's hurting me. I must be working really hard. I'm so dedicated to my task. Like I'm willing to accept this sacrifice that I have chosen to do something else. And that sometimes sin feels like that to me, where, you know, as I get tangled up in something, you know, even what should warn me that I've gotten myself into trouble, even the stings of conscience or the pain of what I'm doing or any qualm can be something I rationalize as that I'm working hard or that I'm being brave. And that it's useful to remember that that always might be a signal that I need something more than just my own sense of strength. You know, triumphing over everything isn't a virtue. And to kind of understand what to do when I've gotten tangled up in sin, you know, I needed to go beyond the rosary. What I didn't expect when I kind of converted to Catholicism is that confession would turn out to be my favorite sacrament. Because from the outside, that sounded ridiculous. Like, for one thing, I didn't hear people talk about confession ever. You know, people talked about going to adoration or about hymns they loved. I didn't often hear people for a while go, oh, I went to confession, that was awesome. Like, oh, I'm going to confession, I'm really happy about that, you know. Because that would be bizarre. Oh man, like big weekend of confession time. Because, you know, what I was kind of picturing before I was actually doing it, when I was only seeing it from outside, is what could confession be? Like, it's that I've done something terrible, so it's terrible to be there and be reminded of it. I was trying to even understand what I would be bringing to confession. What is my part in this? What's my basic? I mean, is it that I just feel so horrible that God feels like also horrible? Like, is it this kind of like mutual embarrassment where I'm like, no, I'm the worst, and God's like, oh, stop complaining. let's just leave. Let's both of us leave. And you know, all these things are what I thought outside. And then when I actually went, like, it was quite different. It was something very different than what I pictured, because I was kind of picturing only kind of human reconciliation, where a lot of the time apology is kind of a like, I have made a large apology. We can both like go now, right? Like, I don't know how to get through this with you. Uh-oh, but here I am, here you are. Let's have this end, you know? But with God, it's different. For one thing, with God, it's not just a simple wiping out of what has happened, that kind of like mutual embarrassment, mutual amnesia, because that's too small a thing to ask of God in confession. If I say, you know, I've sinned, I've screwed up, I'm wounded, can we roll back the clock? Can we roll back to just before I did that? That is too small a thing to ask of God in confession, because just before I did that is just before I did that. I'm not different. I'm not changed. I'm just on the cusp of the sin right again. That what actually has to happen in confession is something larger than just, you know, undoing a sin. And this is where something that I found really helpful to understand it, to kind of translate what I was doing into something I knew was from, used to do pottery classes, so pottery repair. Confession is very like pottery repair. And I'll tell you why. There are a number of ways to fix a broken pot. The preferred way, if it's a pot that your parents really love, and you have broken it and they're not home, and they won't be home for a little while, it's like you go and you get the extra strength epoxy, and you fit everything together very carefully, and you turn the cracked side so it's like not the part that faces out, and hopefully no one ever knows again that this pot was broken. And that is definitely the conventional method of pottery repair. Heal things invisibly, return them to their original state. That's what fixing is, right? It's erasing the damage. And then there's this other form of pottery repair, a Japanese art form of pottery repair called kintsugi. And it's different. You're still binding things together with epoxy, but the epoxy has gold in it. So it's not clear. It's gold. You can't not see the crack. The crack is veined with gold. So the pot will never look like what it was. It's different. You've made the wound a sight of beauty in the pot. And that's really what I was being offered in confession, why it was something more than just kind of cringing and apologizing and then moving on and trying to get out of there as quickly as possible and return to whoever I'd been. And to, really, you would almost otherwise imagine that you could want to erase both the sin and the confession together. And what Christ does instead is he transfigures our wounds, just like his were transfigured. That, you know, the sin that I've already committed by the time I go to confession. You know, the confession isn't what makes the sin real, isn't what makes it important. It's already happened. Kind of worrying about confession as thinking about it as a place of sin is almost like when you fall down and skin your knee and don't look at it, you know, because it won't be there until I look. I'm already wounded before I go. Like, the wound happened at the moment when I sinned. But this is the moment where I ask for help. It's a very different moment. This is the moment where the help I receive isn't just a matter of erasure and isn't kind of a blotting out of me or who I was. It's transfiguring. It's meaning that I can look back at something that is shameful, that is still shameful, but I can never see the shame without seeing God's love running alongside the inside of the crack. That, you know, even my sin, it can never be untouched by God's love for me. That the next time that I'm on the brink of the same sin, when I think back to what God's done, it's not, God forgave me, God undid this, God transfigured this. Like, he'll help me now too. In everything I do, he wants to transfigure my life. Even in sin, he wants to do it. So how much more anywhere else? If when I offer him my wounds, he makes them marks of his grace, what will he do with anything else I offer him? And that's kind of what I've tried to hold on to in a lot of my prayer, that the smallest things I offer him, he'll take as instruments of his grace. When I think about, you know, the instruments on the edge of a story, he'll show me something about Christ. When I bring him just my time, he'll help me have the habit of listening to him. When I bring him my sins, he'll give me a blessing. And so a lot of what I do in my prayer life is just finding the smallest thing that I can offer to God right this second, even when it's not a very exciting prayer or a very interesting prayer. Even when it's not kind of the prayer I know is the best prayer, and when I'm in a fight with someone even, you know, and I know that the prayer that people who are better people than I am pray is like, oh Lord, let me be reconciled with this person. Like, that is definitely the right prayer, and when I can offer it, I do. But a lot of times, like right after a fight, I can't. Like, if I picture the other person coming back and like, all's forgiven, you were right, I was wrong, everything is fine. Even if I picture kind of that, like the best, I'm like, I don't want to be friends with you again. Like, right this minute I hate you. Like, I don't even want to be reconciled. Like, maybe I will tomorrow, like, who knows? But I don't want to wait till tomorrow to pray to be reconciled when I feel better. I want to have a way to still have God in my life right now. So what I do then is I'm like, well, I don't like this person. Like, I still don't like this person. I can't actually pray to be reconciled with them because then it's a lie. I don't want my prayers, even well-intentioned ones, to be lying prayers. Like, I don't want to go to God and go like, I found the script. This is what it says my character should say. It's your line now. Yeah. Because then I'm not praying. Like, the script, I don't know. So what I tried to do then is like, well, like, I can't say I want to be reconciled. It's just like untrue. Well, I wish I could pray to be reconciled to this person. I can't, but I wish I could. Like, I'll pray for that. I'll pray for the grace to actually want to be reconciled with this person. And if that grace is granted to me, then I'll pray the next prayer next. But I still have something I can pray honestly that's, you know, pointing in that direction right now. And if I can't even say that, I'm like, oh no, but what if God grants that prayer? And then I pray to, and oh gosh, that'd be terrible. Well, I'm a mathematician, I know induction. I can step one step further back and go, okay, yeah, I don't want to be reconciled with some person. I don't want to be reconciled with this person. I want to be reconciled with this. That one is true. Like, I can say that. And honestly, I've almost never been angry enough at someone that I've needed more than two steps of the domino chain to be able to say, ask something honestly of God, something I know he wants to give me, but to be able to honestly invite it in. But in those three-step moments when, like, I really can't, that's when I just kind of throw up my hands and say what is always like the smallest but most helpful prayer I possibly can, especially in interpersonal conflicts. He's like, Mary, would you please sort this out? Thank you. Like, yes. Because I have faith that, like, Mary looking down at me and someone else who's fighting, since she takes both of us as her children, will never will anything between us but reconciliation, anything but either of our goods. And I don't at the moment, like I don't. But I can ask her to do it and ask her to give me the grace to wind up aligned with her will. And again, that's a prayer I have faith that God will always want to hear from me and want to extend that grace to me. But it kind of gives me a way to say my littlest possible amen to this forgiveness. Why is going, well, I just don't have it in me today to actually love this person, but I know Mary does. Like, please love this person on my behalf. Please love me into loving them because I can't do this and I know that you can. And it's my way of offering anything I have on hand, you know, my time, my sins, my delegation skills. Mary, this one, this is, I've done my part, which was telling you about this fight. So please, like, help me out. I mean, the beautiful thing is that I feel like, you know, the more I do that, the more there doesn't ever have to be a moment where I can't pray. That my prayers can be tiny and they can be ridiculous. They can be logistically complicated, like they can require exponential notation. But there never needs to be a moment where I'm sundered from God on my end, where there isn't something I can offer him. And to be honest, sometimes like the ridiculousness of my prayer life is a comfort to me. Because sometimes it's hard for me to picture how God's love for me exists alongside, you know, my weakness. How someone who is God, who is all things, who is sufficient in himself, who is like existence himself, what it is he has to do with me. And I can know it intellectually, right? I read about God and like, well, definitionally, God does love me. Like, definitionally, that's very comforting. Like, I'm sure that's a true proposition, right? But it's hard for me to understand what that looks like lived or what it means. And sometimes when I'm like, well, like, here's what I have brought you today, God. Like, I have brought you, like, these sins and confession. Yep, like, I gave you those. And this, like, very weird and convoluted prayer. And then this, like, a whole mess of thing I just, like, tried to hand off to your mother. Like, all these things I have offered to you today. You know, and that's when I feel like I've offered you, like, being on the phone with someone else. Like, they were praying, and then I tried to, like, do an elaborate mime thing to talk to you. Yeah. This was our day that we spent together. I mean, there is an analogy I can think of where it's a loving relationship. Unfortunately, it's of a cat who brings you like dead mice in your shoes. If you've ever had that happen, where the cat is like, I love you. Like, I have brought you this dead mouse. And the person above a cat can look and go, you do love me. That's disgusting, but like, you have brought me the best thing you could find today. That was very nice in your own cat-like way. And sometimes when I try and think what God sees when he looks at me or when he looks at anyone else or when I'm frustrated by someone else, I'm like, I have brought God several dead mice today. He knows what I meant by them. And like for today, that is enough. Thank you. I tried to take about half the time for talking so that we could have half the time for questions, if people have any. Yes, and I don't think there's a mic to go around, so just from the diaphragm.
Okay. Why did you convert to Catholicism and not, like, I don't know, another denomination or Protestantism?
Mm-hmm. So the question is, why did I convert to Catholicism rather than everything else in the world? I will give you, like, the cliff notes of the answer.
Okay.
One is that it was partly Catholicism that made me interested in theism at all. Like, I wasn't interested in general, is there some kind of God? Like, it was too vague a question. So for a lot of the time when I was exploring the live question, I felt like, is there a Catholic God? Like, yes or no? That was where I started. As I was exploring a lot of other things, you know, there were different things that indicated to me that Catholicism seemed more true. One thing was just that as I was kind of exploring philosophically, Catholicism was doing the thing that G.K. Chesterton warns it might do, where it's like a sneaky truth-telling thing, where there are these things that you know are not true, and Catholicism like says these ridiculous false things, and you're like, oh wait, those were, huh, that was right. You had that answer before I did. You deserve my respect, Catholicism. You have sneakily derived, and I don't know how you did it, but I'll figure out later. Get ahead of, oh, no, never mind. So that was definitely a point in its favor. And then for me, it was a combination of a lot of others. That's the biggest thing. And then a combination of a lot of other smaller things, like in Christianity in general, period. It made sense of how it is that I could have a relationship with God at all, why we weren't talking about watchmaker deism, that the incarnation is what helped make sense to me of how it is I can reach up because he's already reached down. And there were a lot of smaller versions of that even within Catholicism, you know, where it's like, wow, I can't even think about Christ. Like, Christ is very large. Like, just because he's God and man, it's not helping with the God part. It's like, oh, like the glory of Christ is kind of refracted through all his saints. Like, you could try thinking about how great God is by thinking through a lot of different saints slowly. And I'm like, okay, that sounds more reasonable. Like, I will, like, work my way up. The Catholicism offers a lot of small on-ramps. Like, and it really, like, it seems like a religion made by God for people in that way. Oh gosh, how does praying work? I have given you ways to pray. Oh good, like, how does forgiveness work? Like, what, it, should I just apologize to you privately and then spend the rest of my time thinking about whether I did it? No, no, like, I am helping you. Like, I am giving you sacraments. You will never have to wander the world going, am I with God? Like, we have some ways that you can know that. And then, you know, he can be anywhere, but you have ways to go and know that you're with him. Stop fussing so much. Some of those may be more comforting to me personally than to everyone else in the world.
I know a lot of converts had trouble with the issue of Mary, and you talked about praying the rosary, so I'm just wondering what your journey was with her.
Yeah, so for me, you know, I didn't come out of a different Christian tradition. So, like, Mary was so not the biggest problem. Like, the biggest problem was God. And, like, if something, from my earlier perspective, right, as ridiculous as God could be true, like, Mary was much less of a lift. Like, if God would give me God and his son, like, and the Eucharist, like, that he is offering me one additional thing was less weird. Like, it's just an embarrassment of riches in Catholicism, and this was far from the most surprising of the things that were being offered to me. Okay, so I was blogging as an atheist at this website called Patheos, which has people blogging from a lot of religious traditions, including none at all. And then I decided I was going to convert to Catholicism on the, like, I don't know, like the 2 a.m. before Palm Sunday of 2012. It was like really, it was really liturgically nice, but this left me in an awkward position. So what I actually did is, you know, when I decided I was going to convert, the first thing I decided is that that was private for a little while. That, you know, even in the moment when I was changing my mind, you know, when I said what was ultimately kind of the moment I changed my mind, I said to my friend, like, well, look, look, just because I say a thing doesn't mean it's true. Like, give me a second to think about this. No, okay, like, I'm doing this, but I wanted to spend a little time discerning privately, which meant, like, no one else knowing, making sure that what I was doing made sense, which meant I didn't even tell. Sorry, I meant to not tell almost any of my friends, and then, like, I started just blurting it out to them because I was excited. So, like, I briefly didn't tell people, and then I told a lot of people. And then, like, my parents got a super weird, like, email being like, hey, I am converting to Catholicism, but I live in a different city right now, so I'm going to come up and tell you about it, but it would be weird to just schedule a visit and then surprise you that I'm converting to Catholicism. This is a letter to tell you why I'm coming up by train next week. Bye. Which is super stressful to send. And then, like, I went to a yoga class just so that I wouldn't be near my email for a little while. And, like, check. But so, like, that was all part of it. Then once I kind of felt really secure in my decision, I emailed the people who ran the site. I'm like, hey, what if I blogged on the other part of it? What do you think about that? Surprise. which they were on board with. And what I was doing actually all through the meeting, I was just being very careful not to write anything that what I didn't believe. Which meant I was doing, like, not apologetics for atheism or attacks on Catholicism, but writing, like, general things about making moral decisions or about theater reviews or other things of that nature. And then after I'd spoken to my parents and my friends and my roommates and, like, many other people, is when I just, like, took a day off of work and, like, posted on the internet for people to see, hey, guess what, and moved on from there. Worked out pretty well.
Going atheistic community that you came from?
Yeah, so like the Catholics were just like, woo! It was like... I mean, there were some words involved, but like that was the gist of it. Like among atheists I didn't know, like at all, who only heard about me through the context of this announcement, like it was more like, ah, oh, that's pretty stupid. And I'm like, hey, I've never heard of you, person. Like, okay, drive by, commenter, whatever. I don't know, it's like slightly snarky. So like there was a couple, like again, like it's good that like the better people know you, the better their responses are. That's like a nice sign. Like the glancing ones were the only ones that were jerky, but since people were like, I don't know, did she have a stroke? I was like, I'm so well behaved that I can't resist. I'm like, hey guys, people have asked whether I've had a stroke. Like, that's a super important question. Strokes are really dangerous. It's so good to know what the warning signs are. I'm going to go over them now. Like, you could save a life. And I'll mention them, like they're super important. Like the acronym is FAST, face, like ask the person to smile, and if they're not on one side, that's a warning. A, arms, like lifting them up and one is farther down. Speech, is it slurred? And the T is for time. Time isn't a symptom, it's how important it is to treat a stroke. Thanks all for asking. So that was nice, like, and that relieved my feelings on that matter pretty much completely. And then from the actual people who knew me. So I had some atheist friends who, before I converted, like I'd be, when I was a senior in college even, like in my debate group, making arguments that I didn't think were Catholic arguments. And people go, well, I was speaking, which is rude. Convert, convert already. And I'm like, you're on my team. Like, would you not push me? So those people were like, well, like, this was logically consistent. Like, I have people, you know, like including my parents, who don't think I'm right, but like the method I use to get where I am, like, and wouldn't want me to not follow my convictions or my understanding of the world, even if they think the thing I've derived is wrong, which is how I feel about them. So this is like nice and symmetrical, right? Like people seeking the truth in good faith who have wound up with incompatible answers, but are doing a lot of things right along the way. You don't expect they're going to fix the error by abandoning the method. You just expect they have to keep pushing it further. The best response I got was when I noticed that there was inbound traffic from a website I didn't recognize to my blog, and I like tracked it back to its source. It was this message board, and there was a post titled like "How to Advice on Thwarting a Catholic Conversion." Reading it, it's about me. It's a person like going like, "My friend is becoming Catholic, like, and I think Catholicism isn't true, so like I don't want her to believe wrong things, and I don't want, and like." I think it says things that are wrong, right, that will have consequences in her life. So like, do people have advice on like how I can talk to her about this? We're like offering different advice, like, have you tried discussing this? Have you tried not speaking to her until she like does it? And the person's like, no, because that's stupid. Like, what? And so I like managed to figure out who was behind the username. And then I just like messaged him like, hey, link. He's like, oh my gosh, I didn't mean for you to see that. I'm like, no, like, that was like the best reaction anyone had. Like, that was really respectful. You think I'm making a decision with consequences, which I am. Like, you care about truth. And like, you didn't even like come to me in a fluster. You went, wow, this is really important. I should think about how to discuss it. Like, you have done everything right. Also, you are hilarious. But like, so like, that was my favorite reaction I got. And I think it was a generous reaction, honestly, right? Like, he thought it was a large scale thing that deserved thought. And you can't ask for better than that. Yeah, so I've been blogging like a little bit before, not about religion, just because a bunch of my friends blogged, and especially over the summer, it was a nice way to like keep all our ideas in dialogue. I wound up blogging about religion because I read Jennifer Fulweiler's blog, which is now called Conversion Diary, and like used to be called Et Tu, Jen, for like, Et Tu converting to Catholicism, but then she decided like on a more dignified name later. And it's because I was arguing with my Catholic boyfriend and like my Catholic and Orthodox friends about religion. I thought our arguments were interesting. I like to think by writing some of the time, so I figured it'd be interesting to write them up, period. And it would be nice to my boyfriend to not have him be like the only Catholic I was in dialogue with. Chris, be the whole of the church to me. Chris, explain the super obscure thing you probably don't know. Like, hey Chris, like all my feelings are riding on this, like better go read the catechism. Like, I don't know, maybe that's good for his spiritual life, but like, who knows? So I'd seen her example of kind of bringing in a lot of people in dialogue and learning more than speaking to a single person, and I liked that, so that's why I was doing it.
Mm-hmm.
When you change, do you still like continue to like wrestle during prayer, like trying to take control of the whole thing rather than like, the child aspect of like, okay, God, lead me?
Yep, yep, that is definitely true. So there are some parts of my prayer life that are more successful, but like easier for me to kind of leap into, and some parts that are much harder, and some of that varies over time. Like one of the parts that usually is a part I don't freak out about my prayer life is just the liturgy of the hours, because I have that kind of comfort of this has all been handed to me, like I can just receive it, and that's fine most days. Like if I am reading through all this and praying it, that's lovely. Like that's not, and I kind of have, don't have weird expectations for myself about it. It's not how I feel about all forms of prayer. If you buy Arriving at Amen, seven Catholic prayers that even I can offer, you will notice that none of the seven prayers is contemplative prayer. That is because I'm still so terrible at it, I did not have anything helpful to say about contemplative prayer. I tried doing it for Lent, like for 5 minutes a day, and it was just horrible all the time because I can't sit still or be quiet or any of those things. So like my new strategy for contemplative prayer is when people ask me what kind of prayers are hard for me, to mention contemplative prayer, and then to say that if any of you like are comfortable with contemplative prayer, to pray for me doing contemplative prayer and like offload that onto you for a bit. I'm hoping will work. But you know, so, and I expect that like later in my life, some things that are easy will become hard, you know, depending on what else changes. Contemplative prayer might one day be approachable, but like I'm not putting a lot of money on that one. And my task is more like, as different things are hard or easy, just making space for them a bit, and then worrying about the next thing as it comes up. Yes.
When you were an atheist, what were your perceptions about religious individuals?
Mm-hmm. So these varied over time a bit. So like when I was an atheist in high school, since I had almost no personal contact with people who were religious as far as I knew, I mean, presumably there were some who went to my high school, maybe. Not sure, honestly. Most of my experience of religion is religion when it interferes with me in the political sphere, because otherwise it's not entering my life. So like, if you ask me, like, what do religious people do? I would say, like, they try and stop evolution from being taught in science classes, and I hate them. And in fairness to me, that's like not a very good thing to do, like the hating or the stopping like of science classes. But so I didn't have a fuller portrait until I went to college. And that was kind of the gift I got, aside from just the fact that my friends were chatty and argumentative, which was already a great gift that you should give to all your friends, was that because I was in debate, and it was philosophical debate, not competitive debate, so people are only arguing what they actually think is true, and there are no judges in the room. It's just us arguing. You win if you change your mind or someone else's. Both those count as a win. I got to see a lot more of religion. You know, because we had some arguments that were kind of explicitly about religion, or even closer to explicitly about morals. And we'd have a debate about like how should schools be organized. And that would turn out to be like a sneaky portrait of what people's religions were. Like, because how should you organize schools is actually secretly a question about what is it important to learn, which is actually secretly a question about like, what is man? Like, what does he need? How will his ends be satisfied? So like, I would get these kind of flashes of what religion was for people without it always being a fight explicitly about religion that made me curious. I mean, I can give you one example, but it's a weird one, so like, don't use this as your portrait of religion to other people. We had a debate, we had a weird named debate resolved, the guillotine is the greatest thing since sliced bread. We were sometimes like extravagant in our titles of debates. That was secretly a debate about the death penalty and vengeance in general. And people were kept returning to this thought experiment of, you know, you find this person who has deeply wronged you, they've murdered your family, you know, burned down your home, like you're in the desert with them alone with a gun, you know what you... I had this Orthodox friend who goes like, well, I would look him in the eye and I would forgive him. And then I would shoot him. I'm like, I mean, you would, what? And he goes, forgiveness and justice are two different things, and you can do both. And I'm like, okay, you're going to have to unpack that for me at some time that's not 1 a.m. Like, what are you talking? And this is kind of like, I kept getting these weird flashes of what religion were that forced me to ask people about them. There's a particularly weird one, and probably not your opening line when evangelizing, I would assume.
How did you look at Christmas as an atheist, and how do you look at it now?
Well, so I was in New York, right? So Christmas is like a traditional thing in my family too. We have a Christmas tree. We give each other presents. Like, often my brother and I, like the night before or in the morning while mom and dad are getting ready, watch them up at Christmas Carol because it's really, really good. And we have Chinese food and we see a movie because we're from New York and that's what New York Jews do on Christmas. I still have Chinese food on Christmas. It's not like violating the Catholic part, so. But yeah, so like for us, like Christmas is a thing where like the world through historical whatnot has given this day like back to families. And you can kind of build up traditions and ways of showing love for each other around that. But like the Christ part of it wasn't very important to us. It was just, you know, this is a space that like the rest of the world doesn't try and claim, so it can be ours. No, but Christmas Carol is really good, by the way.
I was wondering, like, what were some of the books that you read when you were converting that really, like, touched you?
Okay, yeah. So one of the first ones I read that was really interesting to me and, like, really helped on the way, and especially if you are interested in evangelization, like, this was a really good tactic. One of the campus ministries, the generic Christian ones, just put up a sign that said free books, and I'm like, oh, they're all Christian books. Well, I still have to look. Like, what if I want them? And so I read Mere Christianity. And I was already interested in it, but I was like, oh, this one's free. It's by C.S. Lewis. I'm like, I'm going for it. And the reason that one was so interesting to me is because, like, again, like in the context of my conversion, a lot of the arguments I was having in general were about, like, well, obviously morality is objective. Like, obviously morality is transcendent. Obviously morality is like math, and no one like gives me a hard time about like thinking those things about math. Like, I don't know why you guys think that's a weird thing to think about ethics. I think the reason people don't give you a hard time about math is because like people don't get super into the metaphysics of math all the time, so they don't bother to go like, how can you believe in math without God? Like, even though some of the problems are slightly similar. But like no one takes that approach to conversions at all. People would go after me about the ethics, like, why are you saying morality is objective? Like, what would it mean? Like, where does it live if it's not like a thing that's mostly in our thoughts? And so I was reading the first few chapters of Mere Christianity, I'm like, ha, someone who agrees with me. Like, C.S. Lewis is making a not explicitly Christian argument just about what it means for morality to be objective, like what that means, why everyone already thinks it's true, but like spend some time saying it isn't. That when you even have an argument with someone, no one goes like, I prefer that you not do that. Like, and you should agree with my preference because I'm stronger. Like, no one makes that argument, even though they make it in political philosophy classes sometimes. They go like, that's unfair. Like, you promised, not you promised and I can enforce your promises because I am the will of the stronger. Like, people appeal to fairness as though it's a thing you know you both have in common and can know. Like, anyone goes like, are you a person who believes in ethics? Like, let us nail this. Oh, good, let us speak ethics. Like, you just assume that's a lingua franca. And so C.S. Lewis is writing all this, I'm like, yes, like, all this is awesome. Ah, these later bits about Christianity, like, are silly. But, like, that first part was excellent. Like, what an interesting thinker. How weird that he is wrong about other stuff. and then as I was kind of going more into the later parts, I'm like, okay, like, this is interesting. Like, this fits together. Again, this is a lot of, like, the shape of my conversion. So I was like, okay. Like, I moved from, like, Christianity is, like, so ridiculous as to not actually need refuting. Like, it refutes itself. To, like, Christianity, untrue. But if it were true, it wouldn't collapse from the inside. It holds together. It's like Narnia, right? Like, it's a parallel world that does not actually happen to be true. But, like, holds together and has its own ecology. And if you showed up there, you wouldn't go, this is inconsistent. I, like, demand this world collapse, like, by logical necessity. Like, okay, like, fictional but interesting. And, like, pretty reasonable, all things considered. And then I read Chesterton. And C.S. Lewis is all like, guys, Christianity, like, you already agree with it. It's kind of, like, baked into who we are as people, and it's, like, almost commonsensical in some ways. Like, lots of this that sounds hard is not as hard as you think. It's all very wondrous, but, like, it's kind of straightforward. And Chesterton's like, everything is insane, guess what? You're like reading, you're like, wait, Chesterton, like, these things don't work together. He's like, exactly. You go, what? He's like, yes, Christianity is paradox. You go, sorry, no, what? He's like, yes. Like, there's this great bit where he's like Christianity, like you look at the saints, like you have saints who like killed a lot of people, like the right way and at the right time, and saints who were pacifists and were killed for not killing anyone, because Christianity like only does things by extremes. And this is like a very startling portrait of Christianity. It's like really out of step with either like Christianity's kind of banally dumb and destructive, but in a boring way. Christianity's being nice to people, and like Christians aren't really problems in that sense, but like they're just nice to people in complicated ways, like going around to, and then Chester to me like, no, this is a war. This is a war that you have to fight by really weird ways. And so I loved that. I was like, wow, like Christianity is like both a thing that is coherent in a way, Chesterton, but it's sure not boring. Like it matters if it's true or not. And it's aesthetically something. That was helpful. The third big book for me was McIntyre's After Virtue, which I read in the context of trying to like argue my own system of ethics at people and having them go, psh, posh, that's a silly system of ethics. No one even like agrees with you, Leah. Like, you're very ridiculous. And I was having this problem where I was reading a lot of like new atheists who don't focus on philosophy as much. And in fairness, sometimes because they're focused on specific near-term political goals, like the science classes. And that when you have your back up against the wall on that, you're not going like, metaphysics, how do we, you're like, guys, this thing, it's happening right here. Let's all like do a petition. So I was having trouble finding people who agreed with me who were modern writers. I was going backwards and like, oh. And I was doing these book exchanges with my boyfriend, and he had given me these people, and I'm like, oh, Christian writer, interesting. That couldn't give him anyone back. I'm like, ha, I have found someone who agrees with me, Like, and it's like philosophical work, it's famous, it's After Virtue, it's super awesome. Now you know what I think, that there are people who agree with me. What? And Chris is like, you know he converted to Catholicism, right? He what? He like, that thing that you think and he thinks he didn't think it worked without Catholicism over time, like, well, he's a swear word. So I like really enjoyed McIntyre, and I was super angry at McIntyre for a while. That was really helpful. Yeah, next question.
When you look back on your atheism, do you see instances of God trying to
insult in your life? So yeah, but in fairness to me as an atheist, like they weren't overt enough that I think I was negligent in ignoring them some of the time, right? Like, sometimes it's like small pushes. I mean, God did not create Alistair McIntyre for me, but it was certainly like a help. But like that doesn't look like a form of supernatural help, though it is a form of help. Like the most God-looking part for me was actually that I would be back at school as an alumna visiting my debate group. We have like alumni reunions a couple times a year because we're super enthusiastic like that. Can't go more than 3 months without fighting with each other. So you have to all come back and do it together. And so I was there for, I was there in January for our winter banquet. And we had a debate. I don't even remember what the topic was, but it wasn't a debate about religion. And I was at the debate. I'm like, wow, if you walked into this room and you watched us all arguing, you listened to what we thought, you didn't even know religion was a thing. Like, you just came in, you were doing K-clustering because you were a statistician and you were in like non-statistician words, like looking at this group of things that you don't know much about and trying to group them in ways that seem not crazy. Like, is this a cluster? Like, does it help if I put these all together? Do I learn something? No, I should like reapportion these over here, right? So you just start grouping them based on what you can see and observe. You would kind of wind up with some natural clusters, and one of them would be like all the Catholic and Orthodox and me. And I could see that, like looking at the room, and I was like, that's so weird. Like, I should think about that. And I kind of left it just like, that's weird, like, it's annoying. I need to like continue working on this philosophical problem. And after the debate, we have a banquet at which like we pass around a toasting cup and make long ebullient toasts, longer and longer. The general tipsiness of the room increases. And I think about what to toast, and then I just had like the impulse like, well, like, K-clustering wise, like, I was on that side of the room, I could toast the Nicene Creed and decide to convert. I'm like, that's a really weird thought. Like, why would I do that? Like, I'm not gonna do it just like to eliminate statistical outliers. That can't be why I thought that. But it felt like a live option in a really weird way. I was like, and what I wound up thinking is like, well, no, I think that would be a bad idea to do. Like, I can think of like at least three reasons why, a couple reasons why, and like one, yeah, three reasons. Like, I don't actually think I know the Nicene Creed by heart, so I can't do it. I don't like think that that's the right way to convert to Christianity. Like, aside from the fact that it's not actually the fullness of conversion, like doing it in like this weird showy way is like really in line with the aesthetic of my debate group, but like doesn't feel like a particularly Christian way of doing it. Oh, and I don't believe in God. Like, so all those seem like pretty solid. Yeah, I'm not doing that. But that was the kind of thing where it just, it was such a weird thought. Like, it was hard to say what it came from. And like, given that I converted, like, I think it came from God. At the moment, she's like, I'm going to put a pin in this and come back to it, not in the middle of a party. And when I came back to it, it was actually when I came up to the next debate reunion, which was the weekend of Palm Sunday, and had, it was an education debate. Like, it was like, should we have a common core? And I had the exact same experience, like beat for beat. That's my side of the room. Like, maybe I should convert at Toastain. And I didn't even go to Toastain, like, at that point. I'm like, I grabbed this friend of mine who was Lutheran and like I knew wanted to be a priest when he grew up. And I'm like, ah, this is his sort of problem. Like, that seems fair. Like, then, like, whenever I come up for debates, I have an impulse to convert to Catholicism, and I think that is weird, and it's distracting, and it's annoying. He's like, do you want to talk about that? And I'm like, yes, I would like to go talk about it. And we went up to go talk about it, and like 4 hours later, I changed my mind.
Thank you.